space exploration is going more and more into private hands in terms of funding and, you know, the billionaires also that are involved. First of all, what do you think, Thomas, about billionaires going into space?
I think it's so now it's kind of a work in progress. It's just starting. It reminds me of the first steps of aviation on Earth. You know, it used to be like a niche, and only the wealthy or the wealthiest could afford just travel through, you know, from America to Europe on a plane, and more, and then it became more and more commonplace, and a lot of people could afford to travel, and I think it led us to, you know, knowing each other better, and it had a lot of positive impacts. So I'm hoping that this is what we're going to see in space exploration. For now, it's only a few people, but hopefully we're going to open up to more and more people, and the work that we've done trailblazing the low Earth orbit is going to benefit the entire society. So that's what I'm hoping in the years to come.
I mean, I guess, you know, longer term, the ISS then disappears and a lot of the astronauts will be sent on commercial ventures to do some of the technology and some of the exploration. Will it change your job or your mission?
It'll change at the margin, but I think the core of the mission is going to remain the same. What we found out is that our job for institutional astronauts, for NASA, ESA, European Space Agency, and others, is to discover, is to explore, and I think we've done that on around the Earth in low Earth orbit. It's been more than 20 years that we've had a sustained human presence with the International Space Station. There's still a lot of science to be done, and we won't abandon the low Earth orbit. But I think now the time has come to bring exploration a step further and deeper into space. And that's what's always happened on the ground as well. If you look at exploration, you got people going there and try to find out, you know, what the environment is and what you can do. And then more people are coming, you settle, and then explorers go one step further, and then people are following. So I think now it's time to go one step further, go back to the moon with a more sustained human presence, go to Mars. And I think the society is going to follow in our footsteps. That's the plan, at least.
So Thomas, what do you think is a realistic, you know, timescale for a man to develop a permanent base on the moon?
It's a tricky question. And I think right now there's a stage we're at. So to go to the moon, you need a rocket, obviously, which we have. We have the SLS, which is a very large rocket that's needed to go to the moon. You need your ship to bring the astronauts to the moon. And then you need the infrastructures around the moon and on the moon. And that's what we're kind of still working on. So if we're looking at the first flight should be unmanned this year. And then the next first manned flight around the moon should be in 2, maybe 3 years. So it's tomorrow. I mean, it's going to happen very, very soon. After that, it's a matter of years. I think 5-10 years down the line, we'll have started building a base on the moon. And then after the moon, it's a good maybe 10 to 15 years, but then we'll be able to do the same on Mars. So hopefully I'll have a part to play in there. I obviously love to fly there myself personally, but it doesn't matter if I get to do it or not. What matters is that we're doing it as a team, as a group, you know, as a group of nations, as human beings, and I'll try to play my part, whether it be, you know, on a spaceship or on the ground.